Friends, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to SEM Laparoscopy Masterclass 5. Today I am going to share with you some of the important information regarding the sterilization and disinfection of laparoscopic equipments. Let me ask myself 10 questions, try to give an answer. I am sure that will give you some clarity on this very important chapter in my mind. Before that, let us worship and say salute all these three great personalities: Ignaz Semmelweis, who taught us the importance of hand washing; Louis Pasteur, the father of germ theory; and of course, Joseph Lister, the father of antiseptic surgery. Why sterilization topic, after all, is very important for all the laparoscopic surgeon, you wonder? Because this is a very typical trolley or a table we are going to have in laparoscopy. We have a metal equipments, we have all this equipments with the insulation sheath, we have harmonic scalpel, we have a camera, we have all this carbon dioxide tubes, various cables, everything is there. In other words, there are heat sensitive and heat stable equipments are there, and there are some expensive, less expensive equipments are there. So, you need to have not one but several ways to sterilize them. Each one needs a different attention. That is why it is important. And what type of how serious we need to be about this topic of sterilization, if you understand the Spalding's classification, because Spalding has classified all the medical equipments into critical, semi-critical and non-critical. What do you mean by critical? Any equipments when you take into the sterile cavity, for that matter a thoracic cavity, peritoneal cavity or even a joint cavity, it has to be properly sterilized. Whereas, semi-critical, wherever there is a mucosal barrier, for example, see for example, all the flexible endoscopy can be considered as a semi-critical equipments. Non-critical, which are having a intact skin between the equipment and your body, then there is a chance of infection is very remote. So, accordingly, you need to concentrate on the type of the sterilization. See, for example, laparoscopic equipments being a critical equipments, ideally we need to achieve sterilization at best or even at least a high level disinfection. So, what do you mean by sterilization? We need to understand these two terminologies. Let us go back to our basics of microbiology. A sterilization is elimination of all living organisms including all the spores. Whereas, high level disinfection means some spores can be spared. So, you mainly aim for all the vegetative organisms including tuberculosis bacilli, that is high level disinfection. In my opinion, as far as the laparoscopic concern, we need to aim for sterilization, because nowadays we are not only confining ourselves to basic surgery like an appendix gallbladder, we have already moved to more advanced sterile procedure like a hernia surgery where we use mesh. So, we need to go into sterilization by understanding what I mean by sterilization cycle. That is, beginning of the surgery, my table is like this. At the end, it will be all like this, all loaded with the dirt, blood. As soon as you finish the surgery, we need to soak them, wash them, then disassemble and sterilize them. Then you store them if necessary or transport them where it can be stored, used for the next case. So, this whole process is called a sterilization cycle. The importance of the cleaning we need to understand. As soon as the surgery is over, you need to clean them nicely, because most of the bio burden, I would say probably more than 90% of the dirt, blood, bacteria can be minimized only by our good cleaning. For that, we need to soak them nicely early in a nice good quality water. What do you mean by good quality water? It should be a soft water with a less amount of salt content, and we can use either a detergent or an enzyme preparation. We need to ensure that we disassemble all the equipments like this. For example, all the equipments, be it a trocar or hand instruments, they are all modular equipments. So, you will be able to take them into smaller pieces. So, disassemble them. Then think about cleaning them either mechanically with a machine or manually with a brush, or even ultrasonic equipments are available, and you have to rinse and dry, then visualize, make sure there is no damage before you submit them for a sterilization to a set timing, then you can use it or store it. So, these are all the steps we are going to see. The two key words as far as the cleaning either manually is brushing and flushing. That is, flushing means all the long lumens has to be flushed with the running water and also brushed with the various types of brushes available, because you need to concentrate on the areas mentioned, like a junction between the insulated sheath and activating mechanisms, and also the articulating mechanism, the grooves, like a bowel graspers, all the grooves. You have to imagine they are all the bacteria is lurking there, and also long narrow lumens of this sheaths have to be cleaned with the long brushes. So, all these things have to be meticulously done. You need to teach your staff nurse to do that religiously, then dry them, or you put the equipments otherwise into what we call a machine washing, either a tunnel type or a batch type machine, or by using an ultrasound cleaner, which works on the principle of cavitation effect, where you can see what is a dirty equipment can be crystal clear like this after a set time of 20 minutes or a 30 minutes or so. Once you have done all the washing to your satisfaction to minimize the bio burden, then you submit, depending upon whether it is a heat stable, then go for a something like an autoclave, or if it is heat liable or heat sensitive, you need to go for some other modality of sterilization. We have three options at least in our hand: either go for a steam sterilization, which every one of us use day in and day out, like all the metal equipments, by autoclave, ETO sterilization, and a chemical disinfection. Let us go one by one, but my advice is choose the appropriate sterilization method for each equipment. See, for example, if you have a metal equipments, better you go for like a vacuum, that is a porous load vacuum autoclaves. What is the difference between this one and a flash autoclave, if you ask me? Because this particular porous load autoclave, it will avoid condensation, because all the equipments we are keeping in a wrapped environment, and also they have a long narrow lumens. Preferable not to use a flash autoclave, and the set temperature, time, pressure, you watch it, and you can use it for all the equipment mentioned. And nowadays even the telescopes, light cables can be compatible with autoclaving. Better you discuss with your equipment where you are buying from, whether it is compatible. Most of them nowadays are compatible, but because of the fear only, we all compromise on the sterilization. The next best alternative is ETO or ethylene oxide sterilization, which is lesser temperature but a longer duration. But a very important thing is you need to keep after the sterilization on an aeration cabinet. So, you can't use it immediately, it has to be like overnight, you need to keep it, next day only it may be available. So, you need to have a larger volume of equipments, and also there is a risk of inhalational injury and contact injury, and it is rather expensive. And the third one, I am sure 50 to 60% of us will be using, is a germicide, either a 2.4 or a 3.4% glutaraldehyde or a Cydex OPA parasitic acid. But you have to be very careful about two important things: how long you can use it, that is a self life, each time when you immerse or dwell the equipments inside completely, how long to keep it. You have to give a timer there, like a 20 minutes is the optimum, even though Cydex OPA allows you to do it in within 12 minutes or so. Better you watch it with a timer, and also you have to test it periodically within the period of self life. If it is 2 weeks, within the time with the indicator strip, that pH is maintained, and also you should have a good rinsing protocol. See, for example, it is completely immersed, all the equipments. Once you take it out and rinse it, you have to use a sterile water, autoclaved water, because when you use a compromised water, that is where the problem comes. So, there are some limitations, risk of chemical disinfection. One such thing is, of course, the risk of mycobacterium chelonae infection. especially when they are using a contaminated water or a disinfectant if they are using. So, patients after a laparoscopic gallbladder or appendix or even a hernia for that matter, they come with a discharging sinuses, port site sepsis for several weeks after laparoscopy. In those situations, you better confirm with the AFB stain culture biopsy and give them 4 weeks of these drugs, clarithromycin, ciprofloxacin and amikacin. But my advice is these types of nasty infections are better prevented than managed. So, go for a strict ritual of the rinsing protocol. Can I use a formalin chamber? This is a common question addressed in every conference we go. The simple answer is please don't, because they are not the recommendation from our bigger associations like IAGS, ASI. Even though a tight fitting formalin chamber with a proper cleaning and drying equipments, if they are kept in a disassembled status with about 45 grams of formalin tablets, if you are keeping it long enough, more than 5 hours, in a set temperature of 28 degrees centigrade and more, we proved in a various experiments, it gives you a very good high level disinfection. Still, we live in an era where we use mesh, more advanced laparoscopic procedure, and it is very difficult to adhere to all the strict protocols. So, a blanket recommendation is don't use formalin chamber anymore. But is there any newer, better sterilization methods available if you ask me? We used to have a steris method initially with the parasitic acid. Now, using the hydrogen peroxide, we have what we call a gas plasma sterilization or a steroid, which with a shorter duration of 30 minutes for a heat sensitive item, it is able to do this gas plasma sterilization. So, it has a plenty of advantages unlike ETO without a release of any toxic residual. It is safe for the healthcare personnels. It is very fast, but of course, it is rather expensive. The initial cost and also recurring cost is there, but if you are having a high turnover, I think this is the one you need to go for next to your autoclave is a gas plasma sterilization. What about the disposable? Can you reuse a disposable is another question normally people ask, but there are lots of ethical, medical, legal and economical issues we need to address. What I can say is economically it makes sense and also environmentally it is good, but there is always risk of cross infection, because unlike a reusable equipment which are like a modular equipment, here you can't clean properly, you can't just take it. And also there is always risk of what I call infection by some tougher organisms like prions, and also repeated cleaning makes all these plastics in going in for what we call a material and a mechanical failure. So, the patient if they go into any problem, they can sue you, and when there is a problem legal issue, whom to be blamed, it is you or the company, there is always an issue. So, my advice is try not to re-sterilize, and these are all the some practical things I would like to give. Whenever you have 4 or 5 cases lined up today laparoscopically, do the clean operation first. If you have a hernia, do the lap hernia first case, then you do the gallbladder, then the appendix in that line. And whenever you have a same patient, you have 2 cases, 2 procedures. For example, try not to combine a contaminated procedure with a sterile procedure. Like for example, if the patient requires appendicectomy, do only appendicectomy. Try not to venture into a hernia there, because in my opinion, it is a bit risky and it is worth avoiding if possible. Also, whenever you are taking the mesh inside the patient, try to take it through the trochar, not through the skin directly. That way you can avoid any organisms getting into the mesh. And whenever we retrieve any organs from inside, that you always use a retrieval bag, so that wound protectors, so that there is no chance of wound infection. And always consider prophylactic antibiotics in a clean contaminated procedure like a gallbladder surgery, and monitor your sterilization, and also have a wound infection register. If you have 100 cases of lap coli, if there are increasing incidence of infection, always you have to go back, see is there any break in the sterilization protocol in your theater. because that's the way you have to discipline your staffs and minimize the chance. You should have a zero tolerance to any infection, in because laparoscopy itself is a safe procedure and you should not expect to have any wound infection for that matter. There are indirect ways to know and effectiveness of sterilization by a physical indicator, chemical indicator and a biological indicator. The importance of biological indicator, as you can see here, if you carefully see, I have all the organisms given here, the vegetative organisms, fungi and small viruses, mycobacteria, bacterial spores and prions. Let us see bacterial spores, bacteria Bacillus stereothermophilus and also subtilis. If you are able to prove using these two bacteria as a biological indicator, if they are destroyed by whatever method you are using, that means all these organisms here, they are presumably destroyed. That is a very important thing. That is why we use prions are very difficult to destroy. If you suspect prions, the only way is you dispose of the equipment. There is no way to sterilize their equipment. Okay. Thankfully, the prions are not common in our country and countries where they have a mad cow disease, that has been a problem. So, like hepatitis C, B, HIV, all the viruses, as you can imagine, they can be easily sterilized or eliminated by our conventional sterilization protocol. So, do not worry about all those common organisms, even then for that matter tuberculosis bacilli, provided you have a dwelling time of 20 minutes or more. So, ladies and gentlemen, my take home message as far as sterilization is concerned is, after surgery, soak all the equipments early and wash them well, because bio burden is reduced 90% by cleaning. Appropriate sterilization method according to the equipment. If it is heat sensitive, go for ETO or the gas plasma. If it is heat stable, go for autoclave. Always monitor the sterilization process regularly and maintain a wound infection register and always be watchful, and because safety of the patient should be our prime concern. Thank you for watching this.